podcast. I am Shogun. Thank you for joining me for a very special Easter Sunday Church of Camelot meeting. We will be gathering in fellowship, prayer, and to study the scripture to commemorate the Easter season, and in particular, Easter Sunday today, which is, of course, when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ after his crucifixion, his death on the cross for the salvation of mankind. 3 days he was in the tomb, on the third day he rose, visited his disciples, gave them the great commission to spread the good news and ascended into heaven, where he sits at the right hand of God unto this day. So before we get started, just a reminder, you can find this in all podcasts on YouTube and BitChute, and you can also find it on the RT Podcast channel of the Roundtable Discord server. So welcome, my friends, to the Church of Camelot. Happy Easter. If it's okay with you, I would like to start with a prayer. The Groovy Bot is playing some nice worship music if you'd like to listen to that as well. And I'll say a prayer. Heavenly Father God, thank you so much for the opportunity to meet with friends from the Roundtable Service on this sacred day of Easter. Thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross, but also to teach us how to live, show us an example of how to follow you, and show us the way, the truth, and the light, so that we could come unto you and serve him. So we just want to thank you for the opportunity again to accept your amazing grace. We know that through the light of the world, Jesus Christ, we who are blind can see, and we who are lost are found in salvation and everlasting life, friendship, and abundant life. This life and the next God, we give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So, thank you for joining me, my friends. And after prayer, I think also we should read some scripture. So, I would like to read a few scriptures. It says here, "For since death came through a man, meaning Adam, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man, Jesus Christ." So what this is saying is, the reason mankind dies is because of the sin or the disobedience passed down from Adam. All of us, born of the line of Adam, are inheritors of a disobedient nature, which falls short of the glory of God and therefore inherits death. So Jesus said, "For the wages of sin is death." That means that all who sin and all who disobey God will eventually go into death. However, the gift of God through Jesus Christ is everlasting life. So through one man, all mankind was condemned. Through Adam, and in one man, Jesus Christ, all mankind was saved. So it says here, Philippians chapter 3, verse 2, a prayer. Say with him, "I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death." So on Good Friday, we remember his suffering on the cross for our sins, and like him, we need to die. But we die not physically, we die to our sins and to the things that we were holding on to in ourselves that separate us from God. So just like Jesus was willing to lay down his life for us, we need to be willing to lay down our life for him. But all we need to lay down is our sin. Those things, perhaps like me, drunkenness or lust, or some other sin that holds you back from the spirit of repentance. Because you cannot be born again in a new life until you die the old life and sin. So from Acts chapter 4, verse 33, "With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all." So what this tells us is that after Jesus died, the apostles and disciples didn't break up. They didn't say, "Oh, our Messiah was killed. I guess this religion was false. You know, we were following this Jesus guy and he got killed. I guess we should give up and go home." They began going everywhere, preaching even more that he had been resurrected. And this was convincing. Everywhere they went, people were convinced and joined the church because they could see that these people had really met Jesus. And again, Jesus appeared to many of them after his death on the cross to show them that he was still alive. So they went forth powerful, but they would have been obvious liars if they were lying. People knew they were telling the truth. And not only that, the Holy Spirit was at work in them so that they were able to do miracles cast out demons, heal the sick. So the testimony of the prayer to Jesus' resurrection is not only for the testimony of the resurrection, but also for the sick to do miracles just as Jesus had in his life. Because he didn't leave us alone after having received the Holy Spirit to us so that we could do all the things that we could do and greater things in his name, even unto his death. So, in Luke 24, 6 and 7, we have Mary, the Lord, Jesus seeking to find his body after he's been crucified. And an angel or messenger is there clad in white and says these words that we Christians repeat to each other on this day. So when you meet another Christian on Easter, you say, "He is risen." And they reply, "He is risen indeed." Right? And this statement in response is an indication of your faith. Because in Luke chapter 24, verse 6, it says, "He is here, he is risen. He is risen indeed." Came back from the dead. So, just as God resurrected Jesus Christ, just as Christ can never die again, for each of us is going to die once, and we will see the love and die again. So like Christ, we will die once. We know that Christ is the best from the dead and will never die again. Christ no longer has the Christ Jesus, who died more than he was raised to life, is at the right hand of God, and is also interceding for us at all times and all things. He is interceding with us, for us. So, thank you for your best wishes. Is there anyone here who feels that they would like to either say a prayer or read a Bible verse? Or is there anything that you would like to be prayed for you, or do you have a question? If nobody else has anything to say, I would like to continue, but again, if anyone wants to ask a question, read their own verse, say a prayer, or anything, please feel free. But if not, I'm going to continue a little bit. So, again, this is a reiteration in Romans. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. So, Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose from the dead, and by doing so, he broke the power of death itself, not only for him, but for us, so that all of us who believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Christ, by his blood and his triumph, broke the power of death for us as well, that we can have eternal life. In Acts chapter 3, verse 15, it says, "You killed the author of life, Jesus Christ, but God raised him from the dead." And of course we know, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And how can you attain this eternal life? It is easy, it is simple, and it is certain. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And this verse speaks to us on Easter, because it is on Easter that we believe in our hearts that Jesus was risen from the dead. So we say he is risen, and in your heart you say he is risen indeed. And by believing in your heart that Jesus is Lord and Savior and that he rose from the dead, you are promised salvation, and like Christ, you will have eternal life. So Jesus said, "Unto her," Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." So Jesus is the resurrection. He was resurrected, and he is the resurrection. He has eternal life. He is eternal life. He said in Revelation, "Don't be afraid, I am the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, the living. I died, but look, I am alive forever and ever. And the poem, or the song Amazing Grace, it says, when we have been there 10,000 years, singing God's praises, it will be as though it was the first day. We'll have no less time than on the first day. So truly, timeless, immortal, and eternal is the life promised with Jesus Christ for those of us who believe in Him. For of course Jesus says and testifies, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in Him, meaning those of us who die will sleep in Christ, rest safe in Christ, preserved unto the day of resurrection, therefore to rise again and face judgment, knowing in our hearts that we are saved through grace and faith unto eternal life with Christ Jesus. And so, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come, the old is gone, the new is here. I can testify that when we are dead in sins, the person we are is not the real us. It is a relic or an artifact of sin. It's sort of like a shell around the dead spirit, and that is your habits, your addictions, your self-destruction, your lack of integrity or honesty in yourself. These things are what you call your personality. And when that is utterly destroyed, and you are born again in the Holy Spirit, and you become a new creation in Christ, and then you can be a true, spiritually fulfilled person, because it is our sin that holds us back from being who we are supposed to be. God does not oppress us or restrict us. We are oppressed and restricted only by our own sin and repentance. It is the solution to the rebellion against God that makes us unhappy in our lives. So, it says that Jesus Christ has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son He loves, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. And so, with great power, the apostles continue to this day to testify to the resurrection of Jesus. And God's grace was powerfully at work in them all. And I pray that God's grace will be powerfully at work in you, each of you who have joined us in this room today and in this server. Each of us will be called to be closer to God and to bring forth fruits meet for repentance, to reflect in our hearts on those things in which we sin against our own souls, and to come into repentance so that the Holy Spirit can dwell in us, and that we can be a temple for the Holy Spirit and bring forth light in the world, so that we can bring illumination also to other people and show them who are wandering the way to salvation in Christ, who is the light of the world. So He exerted when He raised Christ from the dead, and seated Him at His right hand in heavenly realms. And Jesus promised that just as God sat Him at His right hand, as Jesus overcame and served God, He was seated at the right hand of God's throne. So Christ promised those of us who persevere and are called faithful and true, those of us who persevere in the name and cause of Jesus Christ will be set at the right hand of Christ's throne, even as Christ was set at the right hand of God's throne. And so those of us who follow faithful and true can even have the crown of righteousness to sit in heaven as part of the heavenly government. But even those of us who break any of these commandments will be called least in the kingdom of heaven, such as myself. And even to be least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than anything that you can attain in this world. So, hurry to accept your salvation, and hurry to accept your crown of life, which is offered for you, laid aside from the foundation of the universe. The name is written in the book of life. All you must do is reach up a hand in belief and accept the free gift of salvation offered through the grace of God, and through an act and commission of faith, declaring with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and that He rose from the dead, believing in your heart, attaining to salvation. And so, let us remember, as they entered the tomb looking for the body of Jesus, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed and were afraid. Don't be alarmed, he said. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified, but He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid Him. But Jesus has risen. He walked out of His tomb. The stone was rolled aside. He who was killed, who was broken on the cross, who was stabbed with the spear of destiny, water and blood. blood flowed out into the holy grail. He died. The temple, the tabernacle, the cloth was rent, the sky was darkened, and a great earthquake shook the land. The holy of holies was broken, and blood dripped down onto the sacrificial altar and the crucifixion of the Son of Man and the Son of God. And at that time, the new covenant was born, and those of us who follow Christ were set free of the law and the covenant of the law, and brought into the covenant of grace, whereby we are saved through faith, and whereby our sins are forgiven through the shedding of blood, not the blood of ram or goat or dove, and not our own blood, but the blood of a perfect and sinless man, holy sacrifice for the propitiation of all sins. Therefore, Christians, we call and are called, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen. Okay, my friend, that concludes the scripture section of this Church of Camelot meeting. I would like to ask again, is there anyone who wishes to read a scripture, ask a question, or say a prayer, or request that they are to be prayed for?
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
It's really important. It's like the Holy Spirit's healthy lifestyle that's help you follow the Ten Commandments?
Yes. So the Holy Spirit is the most important part of Christian faith, in my opinion, in the sense that the Holy Spirit is the living, mystical, and supernatural telepathic entity that is in contact with all true Christians at all times. And so Jesus is alive, and he is at the right hand of God in heaven, and he is our Lord and Savior, the Son of God, and the one who will return as the Messiah in conquering glory to establish the kingdom of heaven on earth. However, until that point, he's in heaven, he's not on earth. And God is always in heaven. God dwells in unapproachable light, and no man can see him and live, nor draw near to him, and all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the Bible is full of life and truth and fit for instruction, but we can't understand it properly or interpret it properly without the guidance of the Holy Spirit. So, it is the Holy Spirit and the Holy Spirit alone that allows us to have direct communication with Jesus, and therefore the Holy Spirit, according to God, according to Jesus, will lead us into all truth and all righteousness. So it is through the urging of the Holy Spirit that we know what we should do and what we should not do, how we should and should not apply the scriptures, and what God does and doesn't intend for us to do. And it's the Holy Spirit that unifies us as the hands and feet of Christ. So all Christians are the body of Christ on earth. So Christ is alive in the flesh on earth, but he's in the flesh of each Christian. So I right now am serving as the mouth of Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ can speak through my mouth, because the Holy Spirit can speak to me, and because I have dedicated my life to Christ, I am the willing servant and slave of Christ. So he can say, okay, Shogun, speak for me at this time. Or if I need to hold out a hand and lift somebody up on the street, Jesus can do that through me. Right? So if I'm walking, the Holy Spirit says, hey, see that person on the street, take them to your house, let them out, have a shower, give them a hot meal, pray for them. Then I am doing that. The Holy Spirit is the one that's going to do that. And so it's the Holy Spirit that urges us to fulfill the commandments of Christ. So in the Old Testament, we were given the Ten Commandments. This is of the law. Thou shalt not kill, thou shalt know other gods before me, shall make no graven images. But Jesus brought a greater commandment. In addition to reiterating these, he said, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and all thy mind and all thy soul, and love thy neighbor as thyself. And this is called the greater commandment. So he says, this is the fullness of the law and the prophets. So the Holy Spirit calls us to love God and love our neighbor. And furthermore, the Holy Spirit has what's called the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And the fruits of the Holy Spirit are patience, loving kindness, long-suffering, wisdom, compassion, mercy, joy. And it says against these things there are no laws, or against this thing there is no law. So what this means is when the Holy Spirit is acting in you and on you and through you, you will manifest the fruits of the Holy Spirit. So if somebody has the Holy Spirit in them, you're going to see them become more merciful, more patient, more loving, more kind, more wise, and more joyful. And that way you can know, because you'll say, well, wait, is this the Holy Spirit in him, or is it some evil spirit, or some false spirit, or some other spirit? You will know, because the Holy Spirit will manifest in the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And against these things there is law, so you never need to think, oh, well, he's doing bad things or breaking the law, because the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit never causes you to break the moral law, because it is itself is morally perfect and onto the perfection of the law. Right? So grace superseded the law, because the law is the dead letter, but grace is the living spirit of truth.
Wow, that's interesting. Is that like those trees you mentioned before, like you can judge the tree by its fruits?
Yes. So in the Bible it says a good tree produces good fruit, and a wicked tree produces wicked fruit. A good tree cannot produce wicked fruit, and a wicked tree cannot produce good fruit. So we know that the Holy Spirit is a good tree, and indeed the Holy Spirit is a good vine. So one of the names that Jesus has is the true vine. So Jesus is the true vine, and all of us Christians are grafted onto that vine. So when you graft something onto a tree or a vine, you can cut one part of one vine and you can attach it to another vine. You can actually graft it on, and the vine will actually attach and draw nourishment from the parent vine, and it will actually grow out of it. So as Christians, we are grafted onto the true vine of Jesus Christ, and then the essence, the life energy of Jesus is coming through us. And we know that that is the good vine, of course, because, as you say, it has good fruits. Of the fruits of the Holy Spirit, being again patience, loving kindness, long suffering, compassion, wisdom, and joy. Against these things there is no law. So you can tell if someone says, I am coming in the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Spirit is acting through me, you have the ability to test that yourself by seeing, are they manifesting against the Holy Spirit? Is he being compassionate? If the person is wrathful, if they're hateful, if they're angry, if they are boastful, if they're cruel, you know that that cannot be the fruits of the Holy Spirit, because as you said, a good tree cannot produce wicked fruit. A wicked tree cannot produce good fruit. But if you have a friend and you knew him before and he says, oh, God has touched me, the Holy Spirit has come into my life, and you notice that he is being more kind, he's being more merciful, more compassionate, more patient, more joyful, then you can believe that it is the Holy Spirit.
Oh, interesting. And,
I want to testify again. Today is the end of Lent. I began my most. You got to keep your mind closed at all times, and the sober lives will help you out by eating it for you. So, 45 days ago or so, Fat Tuesday, the day before Lent, I drank 2 sips of vodka to myself on Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day at the time, but I had a dream. In the dream, I found a silver cross.
That's interesting. Well,
I was just talking to my coworker. Anyways, I had a dream. I received the silver cross in the dream. And when I woke up from that dream, I knew that I had given my life to Christ. So it wasn't that I decided I was going to give my life to Christ. It wasn't that, you know, I had the dream and said, you know what, I'm going to give my life to Jesus. I woke up and realized that I already had. Like, did it happen in the dream, if that makes sense. So when I woke up, it wasn't like, oh, I need to give my life to Christ. It was like, oh, wow, I am a Christian now. Like, I'm saved. Like, it happened in the dream, right? And so I drank a few sips of vodka before I woke up, and I realized I'm not going to drink again. I'm not going to sin anymore, you know, consciously. I'm going to give my life to Jesus. And I did. And that's everything. Yeah, and so everything changed and got better in that 45 cents, and today is the end of Lent with Easter Sunday. So I wanted to give this testimony today, because it is the day of salvation, the day of resurrection. It's also the completion of my period of 40 days, which is significant in the Bible. Jesus had to be tempted for 40 days and 40 nights in the desert by the devil before he could begin his ministry. The Jews had to wander for 40 years in the desert before they could go to the Holy Land. And it rained for 40 days and 40 nights to purify the earth in the flood of Noah. So whenever God purposes to do something, it often involves a period of 40 days of preparation, cleansing, or of penance. so I gave up alcohol and medicine for 40 days, and I've completed that, and now I've begun a second penance of giving up masturbation for 40 days and orgasm for 40 days. Because the two sins of mine, like Sir Galahad, one of my characters, are women and wine, meaning alcohol and sex, or fornication and drunkenness, which are both sins. So because I'm a heterosexual man, I attracted women, lust, masturbation, sex, those things I've continued to pursue, right? And also alcohol. So those two things now I'm giving up 40 more days of purification, because we have to choose between the spirit and the flesh. So the impulses of the flesh are different than the impulses of the spirit. And the Bible says you cannot serve two masters, because you will end up loving one and hating the other. So if you spend some of your time dedicated to Christ, but other times you're chasing lust or drunkenness, things of sin, then eventually you're going to start resenting the holy things and just wanting to get them out of the way. Oh, I can't wait to get out of church and go drink more. I can't wait to finish my prayers and go talk to that girl. Right? So you're really not going to be able to succeed unless you go all the way. So I wanted to give up masturbation, because that's sort of the final sin. It's the last holding place that the enemy kind of can have in life in regards to that. So that's my personal testimony, and I just want to share that. I got to chase them. I'll be right back. Thanks for listening.
Congratulations, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Not everybody manages to do something like that.
Celibacy is such a virtue. It's really hard to overcome, I'd say, due to our own nature.
Yeah, well, I managed actually to stop drinking for a whole year, but I did it when it was a challenge. But I wasn't like a heavy drinker before, so it's quite easy for me. I used to like drink once every like 3 months or something, so it wasn't that hard for me. But recently I've been having like dreams, very vivid, strong dreams, maybe just getting killed, so that's connected to anything like that. But,
yeah, and I'm back, so I just wanted to share that with you. God accomplishes all things in his own time and according to his own purposes. And so I don't believe there are necessarily any coincidences. So, you know, there's 3,500 people on the server, which is a very small percentage of people in the world. And there's only a very small percentage of people in the server who are in this channel right now who actually were here for this event. So I would submit to you that, you know, maybe God had a purpose why you in particular, each of you, were here to hear this. Maybe there was some part of this that God intended for you to hear, maybe at a time in your life where it might make some difference to you. So I believe that, and in the Bible it says, of this I am confident, that God who began a good work in you shall bring it to completion on the day of Jesus Christ. So each of you, God has begun a good work in you. There are ways in which he has called you to be a better person. There's ways in which you are a good person in following God. There's ways in which he's already speaking to you and you're already hearing his voice. And there's ways in which he purposes for you to hear his voice more. And therefore, whether you're a Christian or not, in your understanding, whether you're Muslim or atheist in your understanding, there could still be some way in which this benevolent intelligence is reaching you, guiding you, leading you to something good, which will be completed on the day of Jesus Christ, meaning by the time that the game is up, by the time the plot finishes, that good thing begun in you shall be completed. Right? So that is my prayer for each of you, for the server. I'd like to pray some prayers over you guys from the scripture. So the first is the patron prayer of the roundtable server. It's the prayer that was prayed over me by my spiritual mentor that me and a female friend of mine share as well. That's a very important verse to me, to the server, and I pray it over each of you. And again, over the round table, it is a promise from God. And like all promises from God, it is certain and true. So no weapon forged against you shall prosper, and every tongue raised in accusation against you, you shall condemn. for righteousness is the heritage of the Lord, and thus saith the Lord. And as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, I will also read just a few more verses from the Evangelion channel as well. So, it says, speaking of Jesus, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Therefore, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Therefore, we were buried with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in a new way of life. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. So Christ invites us to rebirth, not just to eternal life and in afterlife, but to have a new life as a new creation in this life, where we do away with the things that cause us suffering, the things we hold on to that hold us back, the things about ourselves that do not serve us, that we do not like, that cause us pain. All of this is what is passing away. The new is that creation that Christ intends for you to be and for you to purpose in the world, right? So there's one thing that God wants you to be and another thing that God intends for you to do, but you can only do what God purposes you to do when you can be what God purposes you to be, and you can only be what God wants you to be when you're willing to die to what you want and let go for those things that you hold on to but God wants to take out of your hands. Because you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk therefore as children of light. So, in these notes, I would say, hallelujah. We give thanks because Christ has triumphed. He came to earth to destroy the power of Satan, and by his crucifixion and his perfect walk, he broke the power of Satan, so that none of us would be bound here in this fallen creation against our will. The chains that bound us here through sin have been broken, and we have been given the key out of this prison. Lord Jesus has given each of us a key. It is the key to salvation. It is the key to the kingdom of heaven. Jesus has the key to death and Hades, meaning death and hell. He has unlocked the door and left it open. We can follow him out into his Father's kingdom. He said, I go now to my Father's kingdom to prepare a place for you, for in my Father's house are many mansions. And he said, were it not so, I would not have said it to you, meaning I would not lie to you and tell you truly. I go to my Father's house, there are many mansions, I go to prepare a place for you. So Jesus Christ awaits us in his Father's kingdom. He has prepared for us a place there, awaiting us. But we have to follow him, right? He can only go so far. He can leave us the trail, he can prepare the house, he can unlock the door, and he can leave us our home with the door open waiting for us. But if we don't follow him, there's nothing else he can do. So he's come and he's shown us the way. We have to follow it. We have to pick up our cross and follow him. And all we need to do is believe, because whoever believes shall not perish but have eternal life. So simply believe on Jesus Christ. Believe that he rose from the dead on this day of all days. Believe that he is risen, and you shall be saved, you and all your household. So, that being said, I'd like to close with prayer. Unless anyone else would like to ask a question, ask for prayer, or say a prayer, or read a scripture. Does anyone have anything they'd like to add?
Just as kind of like a symbol of us, a sign of mercy for those that maybe are having doubts within their spiritual journey or path towards righteousness. I'd just like to,
yes. Let me read the Beatitudes. It's a great idea. So that all of us can refer us. So I'm going to bring the Beatitudes up. Also, sometimes I refer to as the Sermon on the Mount. And this happens is a great thing to remember because we think so much about Jesus' crucifixion and our faith in him and his function as a means of salvation. But we should never forget that he was a living teacher. He taught us how to walk with God by his example, by his life and the things he did and the things that are recorded about him, and also by the words he said. So we Yoga that he was teaching. Not just someone who died on the cross for our salvation, but he taught us how to live by his words. And we're going to look at some of those now and just bear with me once again. Teachings of Jesus Christ, known as the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And blessed are they that have been persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So, simple and short, but deep in meaning. So, if I can give my own commentary, I just pray that God will give me the Holy Spirit to speak wisely of these sacred things. But when it says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven, to be poor in spirit, I believe, is to be humble in spirit. So to be poor in spirit is to be humble, not to puff yourself up, not to be boastful, not to be proud, not to be braggadocious or holier than thou, but to humble yourself in spirit, because then you can attain the kingdom of heaven. Right, because in the kingdom of heaven, we are servants. We are not called to be kings in the kingdom of heaven. We are called to serve the King of heaven, who is God. So we must be humble. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. When you weep for those who suffer, when you are sad at the suffering of the world, you will receive comfort, right? Because God knows your heart. He knows your suffering. And it's promised that he will wipe away every tear, and do away with even the memory of suffering when all things are set right. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Again, those who are willing to serve will be elevated. Those who want to dominate others will be humbled. The last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Therefore, the meek, those who do not seek to dominate and enslave, right? Those who are humble in this world will inherit the earth. Whereas those who are the tyrants and the warlords, who choose the things of this life, the pleasure and the fame and the money and the power, these things come from the devil, and so they will have their full reward in this life. But those who store up their treasures in heaven will have their reward in the kingdom to come. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. It is said, knock, and the door will be open, ask, and it shall be given. If you ask your father for a loaf of bread, will he give you a stone? In other words, you will receive what you ask for. So be careful what you ask for. When Solomon prayed for wisdom, God said, because you are wise enough to pray for wisdom, I'll give you wisdom and everything else as well. So here it's saying, blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness. So if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, God will give you that. He will fill you and give you righteousness. Whereas if you hunger and thirst for the pleasures of this world, you will always be hungry, right? Because these things leave you hollow. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Jesus said repeatedly, judge not, lest ye be judged. As you judge others, so shall it be measured unto you. Worry not about the speck in your neighbor's eye until you've taken the log out of your own. There is but one God and judge, but who are you? A mere man to judge your neighbor. So Jesus said, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. None of us are without sin. All of us must be merciful in order to be forgiven. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. It says in the Bible, draw near to God and he shall draw near to you. So purify yourself that you can see God. 1 second. And finally, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. 1 second. And so this one is simple enough. Jesus was called the Prince of Peace. He came to bring an era of peace, and we are asked to be his servants and to bring about the peace of God, not through being humble and meek. We are also called to resist justice. injustice and be servants of justice, and sometimes to be a peacemaker is indeed to wage a just war. But we are always in the cause of true peace and justice. And finally, blessed are they that have been persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus died on the cross, and he said that everyone who follows him and loves him will be persecuted on his behalf. He said everyone who loves him will be hated by the world, and everyone who follows him will be persecuted. So blessed are those who are persecuted in his name, count it as pure joy to suffer persecutions in the name of Jesus Christ, because then we can share also in his glory, thereby we can serve him. And those of us who are martyred or persecuted in his name have a very special reward in heaven, in a crown of life and a crown of righteousness. So if people curse you or dislike you or cut ties with you because you testify to Jesus Christ, or like Yusuf Bakura, who was kidnapped by Boko Haram recently, and they were going to cut his head off because he was spreading the gospel, he has a great reward with Jesus Christ, and our prayers were answered. He was set free, and he is safe, and we give thanks and praise for that answered prayer as well. So thank you very much, Supermortuo, for asking us to go over those Beatitudes. That is the Sermon on the Mount, and we should remember that when we remember that not only did Jesus die and rise again for us, but he also lived and taught us how to live. And the Beatitudes sum this up, and even more so, I will reiterate, love your Lord, your God, with all your heart and all your mind and all your soul. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Even as you do unto the least of these, so you do unto me. So if you're passing a woman or a man on the street who's hungry or thirsty, and you give them a bottle of water or buy them a coffee or even just say a nice word to them, you've actually done that for Jesus Christ, and you will be accounted that reward. So imagine when you go to face judgment, how much you would give for the opportunity to do something for Christ, to have given him a glass of water on his way to Calvary when he was carrying the cross, or to give him food when he was hungry. You would jump at that opportunity, but you have that opportunity every time you see someone in need. And the parable of Lazarus says that when the rich man passed by this poor, wretched man named Lazarus, who was hungry and covered in sores, and the man begged every day for a few pennies, and this rich man never gave him any pennies. And then in the afterlife, he was in Sheol, burning in this fire, and this man, Lazarus, was in heaven. And the rich man said, please, Lazarus, give me some water, because it's hot down here. And he said, I wish I could, my friend, but there's a chasm. I can't help you. I can't cross over. And then Jesus says to the rich man, he said, didn't you pass this poor man every day? Couldn't you have helped him at any time? And yet you want him to help you now, right? So the message here is don't be flippant. If you pass someone who you can help, a homeless person, for example, an animal, don't walk by, because this is your opportunity to give spiritual or physical comfort in this world so that you can receive mercy in the future when you need forgiveness. Because in the Bible, it says there was a debtor who owed this man, say, 10 coins, 10 gold coins, and the man couldn't pay it back. So the rich man who he owed it to forgave him. He said, you know what? I forgive you. I know you can't pay me back. It's okay. I absolve you of your debt. But that guy was owed one gold coin by an even poorer man, and that even poor man couldn't pay his debt either. So the guy who had owed the 10 was like beating this guy up and saying, where's my money? Give me my dollar. I'm going to throw you in prison. And the rich man said, wait a minute, didn't I forgive you the $10 you owed me? And yet you're going to beat that man who owes you only one? Because of that, I'm going to throw you in jail, and you're going to have to pay for your debt and this guy's debt, and you won't be let out until you've paid every cent. So God is willing to forgive us, right? God is very willing to forgive us for our sins, but he's not willing for us to be hypocrites. So if God is going to forgive us the sins that we have committed, we have to forgive other people. And also, if God is going to be giving us blessings and be kind unto us, we can't harden our hearts and walk by a poor man when we're wealthy. We can't hesitate to give a bottle of water when we know that we have enough to give. Not because God wants to punish us, but because he hates a hypocrite. And he wants us to pay it forward. And to those of us who have received grace must also be grace unto other people. And we should help people not only because we love them as ourselves, but also because we love Jesus Christ, and we can serve him through serving his creation. Does anyone else have a question, comment, or a prayer request?
Yeah, I'd like to pray for my buddy. We'll call him TJ. My buddy TJ, he's been having a hard time. He's becoming very paranoid about his living situation, and he's really worried about the trafficking of humans that's been going on in the world recently, and his eyes are opening up to new things that he couldn't imagine were the reality, but unfortunately they are, and he's having a hard time, and I just ask you guys to pray for him.
Thank you very much for bringing your prayer request. So if it's okay, I'd like to pray for TJ. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for Dacian joining us today in the server and in this fellowship of the Church of Camelot. And we thank you that you have moved his heart in compassion and love for someone in his life named TJ. And he has the blessing, TJ has the blessing of a friend in Dacian who cares enough about him to pray for him. So we give you thanks for that, God. And we just pray that TJ will receive, first of all, comfort as he goes through a time of stress or of concern facing the dark things in this world. We ask that you will give him comfort and certainty of your righteousness, and that you will not pervert justice, and that always you are sovereign, God, and that all dark things that are done in the darkness will come into light, and all justice will be done, God. So we pray for TJ to have a sound mind, because we know you don't come that we should have a spirit of fear, but of peace and righteousness and of a sound mind. So we pray for a sound mind of faith for TJ. We also pray for all the victims of human trafficking in the world today, that they should be saved, that they should be protected and preserved and comforted, and that these wicked practices should come to an end, and that those trafficking these dark things should be brought to light, to justice, God, and to repentance, to turn away from these wicked acts, which are of the devil and of the adversary. So we call in the name of Jesus Christ, the Archangel Gabriel and Michael, all the angels of the heavenly hosts, Adonai Sabaoth. We condemn those who condemn. We condemn those who practice human trafficking. We condemn those who victimize your little ones, God, in the name of Jesus Christ. And we thank you again for Dacian's prayer. And in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray for his friend TJ.
Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to say a few more prayers. Now I'm thinking of it. I'd like to pray for my friend Harmony. I'd like to thank you for her counsel and guidance in my life. And I just pray that you'll keep your strong hand of righteousness and protection on her and help her to continue to testify and strengthen her in her spiritual warfare and her prayers, which are powerful and effective. I also want to pray for... I'm trying to think if there's any other specific prayer requests from the server. Oh, yes. I want to pray for Mr. Batman and for his wife. Mr. Batman is a brother Christian. He has testified in the Church of Camelot and given powerful testimony. And he is also a man of faith who has shared his wisdom of the Bible. And we pray for his wife, who is suffering from an illness in her health. And in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray that you will heal her and protect her, restore her and her health. And you will also comfort Mr. Batman, who is struggling emotionally, and you'll help him to stay strong, resist the temptation of alcohol in this difficult time, and also help him as he is temporarily unable to do his work. Thank you for helping him to teach here in the server, and we ask that he will continue to find satisfaction in that, and that you will guide him in this difficult time. But especially we pray for his wife, and that she should have a full recovery and not require the surgeries that he fears that she may require. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, knowing that this is a small thing and all things are possible for you, God. I'm trying to think. I will pray for the server, that it will continue to grow, flourish, and thrive, and be a lighthouse and a beacon of positivity and positive connection and social interaction in this world, and a place where the Holy Spirit can continue to move. I want to give you thanks that Zoo was brought to Christianity. That is such a great glory to your name, God. It's such a great victory for you to claim him, for your army, God, and Becky also to have come to an understanding of God. Thank you for revealing yourself to the people in the server, and we pray you'll continue to do so, God, and bring people to the good news in your own good time. And on that point, I think I want to close it with this. When I was reading the Bible recently, the stories pertaining to Easter Sunday, which is, again, the day of resurrection, So Mary goes to the tomb looking for the body of Jesus. The stone has been rolled aside. Body is not there. An angel or a messenger is there. It says, look, Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, has gone. He is not here. He is risen. So that's where we get this message. He has risen from the dead. But after this, he appears to two disciples on the road. He appears to Thomas. Thomas thinks it's a ghost and says, oh my God, it's a ghost. And he says, Thomas, am I a ghost? Look at my hands. And he holds his hands out, and Thomas puts his fingers in the holes, and he goes, he can feel the wounds. So he knows he's a physical flesh and blood body. Now, this is interesting and somewhat disturbing, because you would assume that if Jesus did come back from the dead, that indeed he came back as a spirit, like a perfect kind of spiritual ghost, or that God had physically healed his form and restored him to health. The truth is a little more disturbing. Jesus is alive. He's not dead. But he's also not healed. He still has holes in his hands big enough to put your fingers in. So this is kind of like, was he bleeding? Was he in pain? Right? But we know he wasn't made physically whole, and we know he also wasn't a ghost. Now, aside from that, he appears to the disciples as they're eating, and he gives them the most important teaching that happens here. And indeed, I believe this is the origin of what we call the Great Commission. And I'm going to post something about the Great Commission, which I hope that you guys will watch after the conclusion of this. But anyways, he appears to the disciples, and he says to them, go forth and spread the good news, spread the gospel. So he appears from the dead and speaks to his disciples, his apostles, and gives them the Great Commission. So on that note, I'm going to post this here for you guys in general chat. I hope that you will listen to that and watch it. But he said, go for the good news. So what we can remember is Jesus died on the cross, he rose from the dead, he triumphed from sin, so that those who believe in him shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. And furthermore, he returned to give us a teaching, he gave us the Beatitudes, the greater commandment to love God with all our heart, all our mind, and all our soul, and love our neighbors as ourselves. And finally, he also gave us the good news is simply that God loves you, he wants you to be saved, and he has given you the gift of eternal life, and anyone who believes in Jesus Christ will receive that gift of eternal life. And furthermore, the kingdom of heaven will come to earth, right? So when Jesus prays, he says, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So Jesus's prayer, which we know will be fulfilled, is that God's will, perfect, sovereign will be done on earth as it is in heaven, meaning in the future, heavenly government will come to earth. And so although Jesus has already risen from the dead and already triumphed over the works of Satan once, the first time he did it, he ransomed our souls. And therefore, those of us who believe in Jesus can be saved. Even in this life, we can be free from the power of the devil. But when he returns at the head of a conquering army, he will free the earth from the power of Satan forever in total. And he will bring about a heavenly reign of government, eternal life for all of those of us who live there with him. And we can look forward to that very much. And we can receive not only eternal life in the future, but abundant life in the kingdom of heaven in earth. Because the kingdom of heaven is within us. The kingdom of heaven is inside of us. And actually, I would like to post or play rather one song now to kind of end this event, which you guys can listen to with me if you would like. And this song, I think, is about the kingdom of heaven and how the kingdom of heaven is within us. And I'm going to put that on right now. And then I guess I will close with a prayer. So I'm going to close with a prayer, and then I'm going to put on this song. Heavenly Father God, thank you for the opportunity to come together with the wonderful people of the Round Table on this sacred Easter Sunday. We thank you for sending your son, Jesus Christ, for his example and his teaching, and for the salvation that you have given for all of mankind, for all those who believe in you and all those who accept your grace. So we pray that your grace will flow through the Round Table, through this room, into all the people here, that it will continue to work in their lives and bring forth good fruits of the Holy Spirit, like love, patience, peace, joy, compassion, and all fulfillment, God. I pray a blessing on the server, on everybody in the server, on everybody in this room, on their friends and family. May they be kept in wellness, happiness, and health, God. Shelter them in the pinion of your wing. Wash us with hyssop, and we shall be white as snow. Write our names in the book of life, and cover us in the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. And we pray a hallelujah, God, for all things are accomplished in you. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. Amen. And now for a song. Thank you very much, everybody, for attending and listening. And this song is, again, about the Kingdom of Heaven and how the Kingdom of Heaven is within us.
The promised land is in the palm of our hands, not confined by the lines, drawn in the sand, buried in flesh, hidden in bone. The Kingdom of Heaven is embedded in the soul. In order to return and become whole, we must be humble, surrender, ego, let go of the future and the past. Feel the light that shines right through the mouth. Illuminate the path, draw the mind back. Illuminate the path, gotta draw the mind back. Illuminate the path, draw the mind back. It's hidden in this moment, buried right where you're at. Heaven is here. It's hidden in this moment, buried right where you're at. Lost in a strange land, caught up in this game plan. Trying to find my way back to the train station. Looking outside, but it's not a placement. It's a state of mind. Graceland. Draw the mind back, illuminate the path, draw the mind back. It's hidden in this moment, buried right where you're at.
Now we'll just listen to a few more songs if anyone wants to stay and enjoy them. Thank you for joining the round table, Church of Camelot, Sunday service.
In the miracle, candles in my vehicle, 8 nights, gonna shine invincible, no longer be divisible, born through the struggle, keep on moving through all this hustle, head up, head down, through all of the bustle, New York City, wanna flex your muscle, look so down, look so puzzled, huddle around your fire through all the rubble,
bound to stumble and fall, but my strength comes not from man at all, bound to stumble and fall, but my strength comes not from man at all.
Charge on till tomorrow, wipe away your tears and your sorrow, sunrise in the sky, like an arrow, no need to worry, no need to cry, light up your mind, no longer be blind, him who searches will find, leave your problems behind, you will shine like a fire in the sky, what's the reason we're alive, reason we're alive,
bound to stumble and fall, but my strength comes not from man at all, bound to stumble and fall, but my strength comes not from man at all. One more than what you know how to be. And this is the light of festivity. When your broken heart yearns to be free.
heavy from things you carry a long time. Been up, you've been down, tired and you don't know why. But you're never gonna go back. You only live one life. Let go, let go. Fire, in a fire, in a fire. Live like a warrior.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Because up to that time, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. But a phenomenon was about to take place, because the Spirit of God was hovering over those waters. That's why after all this time, I can stand here today and say, when he rolls up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on the Ritz. He's got thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists. And the Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, so you better be believing. Our God is an awesome God. You see, our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. In the void of the night, he spoke into the darkness and created the light. Judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. A hope we've not too quickly forgotten. That our God is an awesome God. It makes me want to sing.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God.
He reigns.
God is an awesome God.